BBC Audio is proud to present the Bill Bryson BBC Radio Collection, an anthology of the best-selling author's feature documentaries and radio interviews from the BBC archives. This sparkling collection of seven BBC programmes collectively illuminate the personal passions of the world's funniest travel writer, from travel and history to literature and language.
I was in the middle of the United States. It's very flat. The weather is generally hostile. It's either very hot in the summer or very, very cold and snowy in the winter. And it just seemed to me growing up that this was a really dull, it's like serving a very long prison sentence.
Escaping from Iowa in the American Midwest was what triggered Bill Bryson's desire to travel. He first went round Europe before settling in England and for the past few years has lived in North Yorkshire. Recently, though, he decided to revisit his native country. Starting out in Iowa, near the centre of the United States, he made two big loops to east and west, driving some 14,000 miles in his mother's old Chevette. When I asked him, had he first got a sense of a bigger world outside his hometown of Des Moines?
I can remember the actual turning point was watching a television program one Sunday afternoon. It was a documentary about filmmaking in Europe. And they showed Anthony Perkins walking down some street in Paris, or possibly Rome, but it was a cobbled street. It was shiny with rain. He had his Burberry on, and it turned the collar up. There was just something about it that absolutely, maybe 8, 9 years old. From that moment on, I was just hooked. I just thought there's another world out there that I want to be part of.
And yet, there you were in small town America, and now you've gone back to small town America. Having escaped it, you decided to make a journey back there. What was the appeal of going back?
Well, what happened, and it was that my father had died, and when I went home for the funeral, it was the first time I'd gone back on my own. It suddenly occurred to me then that America had become almost like a foreign country to me.
How long had you been away at that stage?
I'd been away for about 10 years consecutively, but I'd lived here for 2 years before that, so I'd been away for 12 out of the last 14 years. It just suddenly struck me that America was, I felt alien there in a way I never had before. And it occurred to me that it would be an interesting experience to borrow my mother's old car and hit the highway and just see how both the country had changed and how I had changed in the period since I was growing up there in the 50s and 60s.
I mean, in terms of travel, Bill, I mean, nobody could really accuse you of being a very rugged traveller on this journey. This is true, isn't it?
Well, I don't know. Some of the motels I stayed in, I thought, you're right. It's absolutely true. Driving a Chevette. I was staying in motels. And I didn't, I mean, I was on a very, very limited budget, very tight budget. And, but no, I mean, it's, you know, America is not like Biafra or something. I mean, it's obviously a very comfortable, easy country to get around in.
But you were, in fact, travelling as the natives do, in a sense.
That's right.
And once you get out on the open road, what sort of visual stimulus did you find? Because there's an awful lot of open road.
One of the things I really loved when I was growing up were the billboards in America, you know, the hoardings along the highways, which everybody agreed in the 60s that they were hideously ugly. And in fact, Lady Bird Johnson made it a campaign to get rid of them, and they did get rid of them all over the country. They've kind of disappeared. And I thought it was a really sad loss because in places like Nebraska and Iowa, where it's just flat and empty, billboards were actually about the only visual stimulation you got. And a lot of them were actually very clever or at least very arresting. Very often they would have some three-dimensional element to them. If it was a dairy that they were advertising, there would be a cow's head actually jutting out of the billboard coming out at you. Or if it was for a bowling alley, there'd be 10 pins scattering, but they would actually be cut out above the top of the board. You know, there was this kind of, they were arresting. They were, and as I say, that was almost, in places like Nebraska, all you got. Now you drive across Nebraska and you see, or South Dakota, or many of these other flatter, more empty states, and you see really virtually nothing. Nebraska is like the world's first drive-through sensory deprivation chamber. And it is. I mean, it's just nothing. You just hour after hour of going down these roads that are as straight as an arrow and nothing much happening on either side of them.
So you were listening to the radio or something, were you?
Well, I was trying to, but again, the problem, and this was a particular problem, my mother's car, because it was a very cheap Chevette and had one of the world's crummiest radios in it. And you could only get stations for like 5 minutes. And so I'd be listening to some, you know, nice old Beatles song or something, and it would fade out, and then there'd suddenly be this semi-demented religious maniac telling me that I had a friend in God or something, and I'd have to start twiddling the dial again, and I'm doing that over and over again, and that in itself became very tedious.
I was only slowly adjusting to the continental scale of America, where states are the size of countries. There's so much emptiness, so much space between towns. The whole business of finding your way around becomes laden with frustration, especially away from the main roads. The highway authorities are curiously reluctant to impart much in the way of useful information, like where you are or what road you're on. This is all the more strange when you consider that they are only too happy to provide all kinds of peripheral facts. Now entering Bubb County Soil Conservation District. National Sprat Hatchery, 5 miles. No parking, Wednesday 3 a.m. to 6 a.m. Danger, low-flying geese. Now leaving Bubb County Soil Conservation District. Often on country roads, you'll come to a crossroads without signposts, and then have to drive 20 miles or more without having any confidence in where you are. And then, abruptly, without warning, you round a bend and find yourself at an 8-lane intersection with 14 traffic lights and the most bewildering assortment of signs, all with arrows pointing in different directions. Lake Maggot State Park this way. Curtis Dribble Memorial Expressway over there. Junction 17 west. Junction 17 not west. No U-turn. Left lane must turn left. Buckle your seatbelt. Sit up straight. Did you brush your teeth this morning?
When you got out into the Smoky Mountain National Park, was this at last unspoilt nature?
Well, yes, but it was too unspoilt. That was the problem. I mean, it's very, very beautiful. You know, you come around a bend and you're rewarded with these landscapes, these vistas that just go on and on, these rolling hills. Very, very beautiful mountains, very green, covered with trees right up to the top. You know, not craggy at all, but just gentle, beautiful mountains. And you can see for miles. And one of the things that struck me was looking out on this landscape is that you didn't see a house jutting up through the trees, or a wraith of smoke rising from anywhere, or any sign of habitation at all. It seemed very, very sterile and unreal, because what it really lacked was people living there, making it, using the land the way they do everywhere else on the planet, and the way they once did.
No walkers, no hitchhikers, no
bicycles. Very, very few. There are some there, and they do have footpaths which are used. There's a long-distance footpath which goes right up the eastern seaboard of the United States and does go through the Smoky Mountains National Park. But you don't see people out walking the way you do in Europe. People didn't seem to be taking advantage of that. Most people I saw were in these massive, hideous motorhomes. And very often they were driving around and not even emerging from them, as if they were in some kind of sealed unit. As if they were allergic to fresh air.
But that, in a way, was very typical, it seemed to me, of what you found on your whole journey. To be characteristic of the Americans was to seal themselves off from the first experience with air conditioning or whatever it happened to be.
Yeah, I think that's the one most basic difference between America and Europe, is that Americans tend to think in terms of the interior. You go to a shopping mall in America, and to see it from the street, it's almost always a hideous expanse of parking spaces, you know, enough parking for thousands of cars, and these very architecturally uninviting flat-roofed buildings. Then you go inside and it's wonderful. It's all tropical rainforest with fountains and escalators, and it's all really, really very nice. Whereas in Europe, of course, it's generally speaking, it's the other way around. Particularly in Britain, I think, you go and you see these wonderful old buildings on the outside, and then you go inside and they've been completely destroyed by some architect who's modernized them and turned them into something fairly plasticky and horrible. But at least from the outside, they have the integrity they had originally.
You had a lovely sentence, in fact, about all this, which seemed to me to sum it up rather well, maybe rather unkind on America, but you say, America never quite grasped that you could live in a place without making it ugly. That's a very damning statement.
Yes, and I do feel very strongly about it. It's always been a disappointment to me that America has been the richest country in the world for a very long time. It's assembled an amount of wealth that's just staggering compared with what the rest of the world has. Even now, it's got 4% of the people, and it uses 25% of the world's energy, 25% of the oil. Amazing. The wealth there is just, it's fabulous. And it seemed to me that so much of it's been wasted on just sort of instant gratification and not on building anything lasting. It's always seemed to me that other countries build civilizations, America builds shopping centers. And I think that's very, very sad.
This was interesting too, because in a way a leitmotif of your travels or sort of markers were birthplaces and death places of individuals. There weren't great cathedrals or anything like that. You were finding your way by where Presley died.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.